telling my story of how mercy can reach you where you are. And I pray the whole world hears the cry of my heart, just to see all the ones I love loving my Jesus. Sin tries to make you high, whispers that same old lie. Keep all your pain inside, 'cause no one will understand. The last thing this lost world needs is someone I'm trying to be. The truth that is sin, just a broken man loving my Jesus, showing my scars, telling my story of how mercy can reach you where you are. And I pray the whole world hears the cry of my, my last song's been sung. I stand face to face with the one who gave all for me. May all I have to show be all that matter most, making your great name known. Let this be my own legacy, loving my Jesus, showing my scars, and telling my story of how mercy can reach you where you are. And I pray the whole world hears the cry of my, loving my Jesus.
Good morning. So good to see all of you. Thank you so much for being here. On behalf of our family, you are just a blessing and encouragement to us. And I know there are many that are watching online, and we're just grateful for you taking the time today to be here with us. When you think about Christianity and all that's tied to Christianity, it's tied to church. And my mom's life is a tale of a lot of different churches, but three in particular. I think of Belden Avenue Baptist Church in the Chicago area, that when we were children growing up there, and mom getting us to church, and the love and care that church displayed to us. And I just want to thank Pastor Safterman and his wife Lucille and their ministry in our lives, and just solid biblical teaching and loving our family well. I want to jump to our church, my church, and we have some friends that are here, that it's just a blessing that they came all the way from Missouri to be with us, and I'm grateful. We are grateful to you for being here. And that church, the reason that we're tied to that church is that my mom poured into my life, and because of that, receiving Christ and then encouraging me on what I believe was a calling to be a pastor, ultimately I end up in Warrenton, Missouri. And so we've got Belden Avenue Baptist Church, Grace Bible Church, and right in the middle is Riverside Baptist Church. And we were here, Kim and I were here as youth pastor and wife for 14 years. And in these last years, my mom was in Decatur, and I want to commend Pastor TJ, because you've loved my mom well, and you are an excellent pastor and an encouragement to me as a pastor, and I thank the Lord for you and your wife and this church family. And I'd ask right now, TJ, if you'd come, Pastor TJ, if you'd come and open our time in prayer, please.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the gift that Joan Mirabai was to so many people. Lord, a life well lived. We thank you for her passion for all people of every ethnicity. That is something that stuck out to me right away, Lord Jesus, and my heart was endeared to her for that. Lord, someone who cared about lost souls. Lord, we praise you for how you worked in her life when she was younger, Lord, to where she came to know you as her Savior, and then had a passion for others to come to know you as Lord and Savior. As we just heard that song, Loving My Jesus, and Lord, we know that Joan truly loved you. And so, Lord, we thank you for the blessing she was to so many people, her love for her family, her commitment to you. And Lord, we give you all the praise for that today. Lord, we pray that you would comfort the family as they are going to miss her and her friends. We're all going to miss her. So Lord, just minister to our hearts and our souls this morning. And I pray that above all, that you would get all the glory in this service. In your name, amen.
Promise good to me. His words, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like the flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine, will be forever.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for being here. Greta Joan Mirabai passed away in Decatur, Illinois on August 29th, 2020 at the age of 87 in the company of her family. Joan was born in April of 1933 in Toronto, Canada to Lindsay and Dorothy Mason. She moved to the United States in the 1950s, where she married Bill Meyers and raised four children in Chicago. She was heavily involved in the lives of her children as well as the schools they attended. A woman of charisma, humor, and leadership, her most important quality was her faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. She became a child of God in 1960 when she received Christ as her Lord and Savior. Through faith in Him, she took seriously the purpose of sharing the gospel with others and often sought to connect with anyone and everyone to share the good news that is redeemed relationship with God. Joan is survived by her four children, Russell Meyers, Randy and Donna Meyers, Mark and Kim Meyers, and Diana and Jim Firak. Also her 10 grandchildren, Justin and Liz Meyers, Laura and Uriel De La Rosa, Gary and Liz Firak, Amy and Scott Hall, Sarah and Jason Janes, Matthew and Michelle Firak, Benjamin Meyers, Christina Meyers, Jody and Brandon Arroyo, and Eric Meyers, and her great-grandchildren, Evelyn, Noah, Caden, Naomi, Milo, Bennett, Atticus, Josephina, Grace, and Augustino. She was preceded in death by her husband, Lou Mirabai. Joan is remembered fondly by all who knew her, by her laugh, her love of the Lord, and her ceaseless prayer. Thank you.
Hello. I'm Jody Furak, and I was blessed with being one of Joan's many grandchildren. I plan to keep things short and sweet today, which is, coincidentally, the simplest way to describe my grandmother. If I truly think of the best word to describe her, though, I think I would choose teacher. My grandmother was the ultimate teacher. Whether she was showing you something in the kitchen, giving me a life lesson, or sharing her knowledge on the Lord, she was steadfast in sharing her wisdom with everyone she came across. One of my life's regrets will be that my grandmother didn't get to meet my son, Augustino, but I find solace in the fact that he will learn her insights. Through myself and my family, her lessons will live on and touch the lives of future generations. My grandmother's physical absence will always be a stain on my heart, but I know she's dancing in heaven with her Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you.
Grandparents are a given. We must come from somewhere. But while all are a given, not all are a gift. And my Grandma Joan was a gift to our family. The long-standing matriarch of the Meyers family, she instilled love, faith, and humor into every family gathering. Though she continued to decrease in height, her long arms would wrap around all who entered, warmly inviting the entire person into her embrace. While I could regale you with her cooking methods, which is essentially cook something, freeze it, and then thaw it before everyone got there. Or I could tell you memories from my childhood visiting her condo. I would like to invite you into the lens in which I see my grandma, my sister in Christ, which in my adult years, she often expressed how she viewed me more as a sister. One could easily read the Bible and see these stories are filled with unique characters. And when you're a kid, they seem like Bible heroes. And if you continue to read them into adulthood, you find these characters are deeply flawed. If you focus closely on them, you realize how absolutely human they are, with their doubts, their pride, their forgetfulness. It makes you wonder why God did any level of work in their lives and why he used such broken people to tell this long story. He loves before fixing. He loves enough to transform, and he loves to redeem. My grandma's life and legacy helps the Bible come alive to me. Through a close relationship with her, I was able to learn how much God loves us because he loved my grandma. She was like a lost sheep, and he wanted to find her. Jesus, the good shepherd, rescued her. She was a bold, prayerful leader like Esther, and she would invite me in to pray with her about the numerous things and opportunities that God would place before her. She would greet me like the letters in the Bible, always letting me know that she was just thinking of me. And I'm sure if you called her, there's probably a chance that she said the same thing to you. And she would always make sure that before we got off the phone, that she would make sure that I knew how much she loved me. She ran like Jonah. She hosted like some Mary Martha combo. And she didn't mind listing her accomplishments like Paul. She prayed like Daniel, and she danced like David, but with clothes on. She was absolutely spectacular. And the reason why is that she lived a life ultimately sacrificed and surrendered to God. He's the true hero in her story, the unstoppable, irreplaceable, all-powerful one who wasn't going to just save her. He was going to transform her, empower her, and give her the ultimate purpose, which was to glorify him and share with others the good news of Jesus Christ. And she did it. She trusted and obeyed. She was flawed, and God was faithful. Now she is flawless by the grace of God, and her faith is complete. Hebrews 11 is this chapter in the Bible that's not necessarily the Hall of Fame, but it's more the Hall of Faith. And part of verse 13 and then verse 16 says this: all these people died still believing that what was, all these people died still believing what God had promised them. They did not receive what was promised, but they saw it all from a distance and welcomed it. They were looking for a better place, a heavenly homeland. And that is why God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. This place was never her home. And I look forward to the day when my faith shall be sight, and we can spend eternity being sisters in Christ, celebrating our God who redeems.
If you'll please stand. Sing, I come to the garden alone. I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. Walks with me and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there none other has ever known. He speaks and the sound of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. And he walks with me and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there none other has ever known. And the joy we share as we tarry there none other. Seated.
A few years back, I'm not exactly sure what year, but I had opportunity to interview my mom at our church there in Missouri, and it's always good to hear a testimony. And if you know my mom, she doesn't struggle to talk. If I asked her a question, she'd be happy to share that. Well, we put that testimony on YouTube, and as I was thinking about it, as we were thinking about this service, we thought not just to hear our words concerning her, but for you to hear her story. And so here's a segment where she talks about how she came to Jesus Christ as her Savior.
Yes, I asked the ladies, and the next, she said, well, we have somebody that would like to maybe talk with you. And that was Mrs. Lambert. And Mrs. Lambert was saved at the age of 38. And she was actually quite well to do herself. They had their own airplane back then, you know. That was something to have your own airplane. Today, even a lot of people have airplanes, but back then they could take off and go to parties and all that sort of thing, and enjoyed their life that way. Well, anyway, she got saved, and her husband certainly wasn't happy with her because she wasn't partying with him anymore. And God just got a hold of her life, and she started having that desire to reach people for the Lord. And So eventually she went to Moody Bible Institute evenings, and during the day she would go, she was called a door-to-door missionary. She would go door-to-door in Chicago, and she had all the streets lined up on her chart, and door-to-door she went faithfully. I don't know how many streets she covered. And I was a part of that ministry myself, as my story goes on, in praying together with her for these people. Well, anyway, she sent Mrs. Lambert over. And that day, I was sending out something to Jehovah's Witnesses. I had a check made out for $10, and I was going to get their books. See how hungry people are, by the way, behind these doors. That's where, you know, there's so many hungry people out there that we don't even know about. And so, anyway, the point is that she told me that was wrong, that it was false cult and so on, and I believed her. And then I said, I was trying to quit smoking, but I can't. And I was trying. She says, Joni, it's trying, not trusting. And then she left. And she went through some scriptures with me. And so then listening to Moody, and on the radio every day was the Christian Businessmen's, I'm sure probably some of you know the broadcast. I heard the testimony of this man that had come to know the Lord, and he was a very wealthy businessman, and he had come to the conclusion that he wasn't going to be afraid of what his family would say, or friends and so on. He made that decision that he was going to go forward and trust the Lord, and that's what hit me. He's talking about his background and how they might not listen. They might think that's not the right thing to do, that you're just too good for that. Why are you doing that? Receiving Christ, he was put that all aside. His soul was more important, and so was mine. So that day, I ran into the bathroom, which I don't know why I did, other than maybe to get away from the children. I ran in and out by the bathtub, and I threw my cigarettes away, and I said, God, I want you to take over my life, and you have to deliver me from the cigarettes, because I felt that wasn't what I needed to do. Now, a lot of people smoke, but that was something I needed for the Lord to take care of. And because I just felt that wasn't what I needed to do. So he delivered me with cold turkey, no withdrawals at all. And he's able to do that, by the way, when we turn to him with our full desire, not holding back. I'd tried before, and then I put the cigarettes up on the shelf somewhere, you know? And I think, well, maybe if I don't make it, I got a pack up there, you know. So, but that doesn't work with God, you know. You got to get rid of it all or nothing at all. So anyway, so the next day, Mrs. Lambert comes to the door, and I open the door, and I said, Mrs. Lambert, I'm trusting, not trying anymore, and it was beautiful. And then I went outside, and everything looked like Oz, the Wizard of Oz, you know. When you open the door, and everything literally shone, and the trees and people and everything was different. And that's when my journey started. This woman searching for the truth, and the truth set her free, which is Jesus Christ and Him alone. And
I'm going to try to do this without crying because I really love Joan. Okay, this is going to be harder than I thought. But I was 23 years old, and I walked into Belden And I was searching for a church, and I had received this letter saying that Belden was in Niles. And I was like, oh, that's close by. I'm searching for a church that's close to my home. And Joan had sent that letter to people. She asked the church to distribute these letters. And I received it, and I went to the church, and I needed a church for my son and me. So I came into that church with a car seat, and a lot of you know that it's so hard carrying this huge car seat with a kid. And of course, I love my heels, so I always came in heels. And I went to the front when the pastor said, if you wanted to rededicate your life to Christ, I knew in my heart that that's what I needed to do. And when I finished praying with the pastor, Joan, of course, comes up to me, and she meets me in the back where I'm gathering my stuff, and she took me under her wings. And I never let go of her, but she never let go of me. And she became my prayer partner from that day on. And we went through so many good times and so many bad times, but we saw God answer so many times. We pray for a lot of you that are sitting here. And we saw how God worked, and he even worked in my life. And so I think what we all should carry from her death is to take people under our wings and help people to fly, because there's a lot of people that need love out there that don't have it and are angry, but we need to love. So that's my testimony about Joan.
Good morning, everyone. I'm going to start by singing a little song, a little bit of a song. I don't want to sing the whole thing, that my mom loved, and I loved it too. And it pretty much sums up how she lived her life and how I would really like to live mine. It's called My Tribute. How can I say thanks for the things you have done for me? Things so undeserved, yet you gave to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude, all that I am and ever hope to be. I owe it all to thee. To God be the glory, to God be the glory, to God be the glory for the things he has done. With his blood he has saved me, with his power he has raised me. To God be the glory for the things he has done. I know my mom is singing that right now up in heaven. It just makes me so happy to see all of Joan's family and friends here. And we're celebrating her life. And we want to share about what she meant to all of us as well as what we meant to her. Each of us here today has been impacted by my mom in some wonderful way. I know I've heard many times, and I'm sure my brothers can attest to this, how sweet my mom was, or how she came alongside them and mentored them in the faith or prayed for them when they needed it most. If I heard it once, I heard it a dozen times. From the time we were small, my brothers and I were blessed with a mom who loved the Lord and sincerely wanted everyone to know him and have a relationship with him like she had. I'm so thankful that she made it a priority to teach her children about Jesus Christ from his birth to his death and to his resurrection. She longed for and prayed for us all to know him as our personal Savior at a young age. And she taught us how to study God's Word, the Bible, modeling that behavior every morning at the kitchen table. I have vivid memories of waking up to the smell of fresh coffee and the sight of my mom reading her devotional while waiting for us to come to breakfast. She taught us how to pray and the importance of talking to God every day. And that was modeled throughout our childhood as we went off to school with a prayer every morning. Such sweet memories of my mom's spiritual walk during my childhood. And she also made sure to be involved at school in the PTA, and she had close relationships with some of our teachers. And one of them, Eve Carter, had us audition for the Lyric Opera Children's Chorus, and I made it. And my mom took me by train downtown multiple days a week so that I could have that wonderful experience that I'll remember forever. And that was the beginning of a love for singing harmony and using that gift for the Lord that I'll carry with me the rest of my life. There are lots of stories, many I'm sure that I've never heard, about how my mom helped to bring someone to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. My mom was bold. If there was an opportunity to tell someone about Jesus, she took it. There were two times I was with her that I remember, and she took that opportunity. And they stick out in my memory because I'm sorry to say that I was kind of embarrassed. One time, I kid you not, we were driving through a toll booth. Of course, that was before the iPass was a thing. She had me get a gospel tract out of the pile that were in her purse, and she handed it to the toll booth guy along with her toll money. She didn't have a chance to say anything, but she had to hand him that tract because she knew she would never see him again. And she knew that those had an impact on people. So I thought, what a weirdo he must think she is. She didn't care if someone thought she was weird. She was obeying God, and that was the most important thing to my mom at that time. And the second time, we were in a grocery store checkout line, and this time she thought it would be a good idea to not only give the cashier a tract, but then proceeded to talk about what it was while the line grew behind her. Again, I was livid. It was more important, I'm looking back, it was more important that this person that she came in contact with knew that they needed to be born again in order to escape eternal death and be able to live with God for all eternity. It was only a few moments of time, but for me, it seemed like an eternity. And again, I was embarrassed and felt sorry for the people waiting behind her. My mom knew that the cashier's eternal life was more important than her being labeled a weirdo, and she was right. I just didn't see it that way in the moment. When I look back at those moments, I'm so proud of my mom, and I want to be like her more than ever. And my mom was known as a prayer warrior. I'm sure her friends, those that believe in Christ and those that don't, would verify that. If you needed someone to pray for or with you, she was a phone call away. I think I will miss that the most. I would call my mom at least 3 mornings a week on my way to work, and invariably she would end the conversation with, "Let's pray about that before we hang up." Was glorious. My mom has a number of friends that are the same, but 3 lifelong friends come to mind. 2 are still here, and 1 is with her Savior, and now my mom has joined her. Barb Scrivener and my mom are whole again and are singing God's praises together for eternity. What a wonderful picture. The other 2 are Nadine Kuykendall and Kathy Duncan. I've already warned them to have their phones ready in the morning because I plan on calling on them every once in a while like I did my mom for prayer. I love those ladies dearly, and I know they loved my mom. One more friend my mom mentioned often was her prayer partner, Carla, who you just heard from. I'm so grateful to Carla for praying with and for my mom and our whole family. I'm thankful that she had you to pray with. I have to tell you, though, life wasn't always sweet, and my mom wasn't always walking with the Lord like she was during my childhood. You see, even though she loved the Lord and wanted to obey him, she struggled to do the right thing, like us all. She'd be the first to admit that. There was a dark period in our family sparked by a decision that my mom made, and that decision had a terrible effect and consequences that shaped a lot of who I am today, good and bad. God knows all about it, and he was in control the whole time. He brought her back to us, and we were able to reconcile and continue our relationship, thankfully. I'm so grateful that in the end, we had a loving, godly friendship and a mother-daughter bond that couldn't be broken. I'm especially thankful that I was able to be by her side, even when she was ushered into the presence of her loving Heavenly Father. Side note, everyone should have a sister like Kim Meyers. She was with me to the literal end, and I couldn't imagine going through the whole last 6 months without her. I love my brothers dearly, but that proverb about a friend that sticks closer than a brother, that's my Kim. There's more stories of how my mom headed up some ministry or put together a women's Christmas tea or a retreat. That really was her sweet spot. I want to thank those who allowed her to do that and worked alongside her. I know she appreciated each and every one of you. I'm also sure that there were times that she had some crazy idea that you thought would never work, but it usually did. I wish I was wired more like her. I also want to thank Pastor TJ and family for all the love and care you've shown Mom these last few years. I know she loved you all greatly. Lastly, thank you to her church family here at Riverside, especially the Johnsons and the Kasterisons and Carol and Payne, who were so faithful to help my mom when she needed it most and her family couldn't be there. I'm sure there's more of you that I'm not mentioning, and I'm sorry. Those are the names that I remember hearing a lot. You are a blessing. My mom had a long and overall blessed life. She loved her grandkids and great-grandkids. Personally, as you can imagine, I wish she had been able to stay around longer and in better health, of course, but God knew when her appointed time to die was. I believe with all of my heart that God chose to take my mom home to be with her Lord on August 29th at 8:25 p.m. And I'm so thankful that I'm assured that I'll see her again when God chooses to call me home to be with my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you.
Thank you. Once again, I love you to watch this video of Mom sharing a time where she took the initiative after a difficult time in the city of Chicago with what was going on at my brother's school. So I hope you appreciate how my mom did ministry.
But anyway, so he went to school, and the first week that he went there, he was attacked in the lunchroom by five guys, and they got him down, knocked his books, and got him down on the ground and floor, and he didn't say anything then. He just came home and told me about it, and I mean, they weren't very nice at all. I think they hit him around a little bit, and he didn't get hurt, like scars or anything, but he was certainly hurt emotionally. But being that he had the heart that he did, there wasn't animosity, would you believe, towards these guys at all. We looked at it as God allowing that. Now, I wasn't taking it lightly, and I want you to know that. It was not a very happy situation at all, and we very needed a lot of prayer. So God, we started praying, and I had to send him off to school each day, and that was very hard. I went to the next day, though, of course, I went to the school and went to the office, and I said, I knew who the leader was. Russell told me who he was. I said, I keep orders. I want you to bring that guy down, and I want to talk to him. And he came down, and I said, now, if Russell, anything happens to Russ, I don't care who it is that touches him, you're going to be brought down. You'll be blamed. Well, nobody bothered him after that. But, you know, it ended up, I would have handed, I was a little spunky, you know. But under the Lord's guidance, I really had a love
believe me, I really did have a love for these kids. I knew that they came from some rough backgrounds. Russell, I explained it to him, and we believed that, but we believed that God could bring something good out of this. And so I started going to the school and, getting to know some of the kids and so on. And there were gangs all over the place. I would just walk right between them and smile and say hi and put on like I wasn't frightened, which I kind of wasn't, or I wouldn't have been doing that, I guess. But it's hard to understand all this, but that's the way it happened. And so eventually God put on my heart that maybe we could have, I'd heard about Tom Skinner and how he, actually not too long before that, he'd been with the Harlem gangs, and he was a top guy, and he had got saved, and he was doing some evangelistic work, and God was using him in YFC, Youth for Christ. And so I thought, I called this fellow that I knew, and I said, I'd like to get Tom to come to school, and I'm going to check with the school. So I did check with the school and check with Russell's Sunday school teacher. His English teacher asked him if we could have him in the class and to speak to the students. And then I had the principal and talked with him, and he agreed. And so we had Tom come one day, and he spent a whole day there, and every group that came in for the English period would come in, and Tom would talk to them about his life and so on. And then he wasn't supposed to tell them how he got saved. If he was asked what changed his life, then he could open up and say that. So I sat in the back of the room while he was, you got it. They would come in and, sit down, and they probably wonder why I was there, but they found out pretty soon. I don't think they caught on, though. But anyway, so sometimes he'd say, somebody'd ask him, but most of the time they didn't, and I would say, Tom, what changed your life? And so there, ta-da, he was able to say it. Well, anyway, so God, I believe, really worked. I really believe that with all my heart. And I believe that these moms that sent their kids there, these black moms that sent their kids there from the projects, were just as concerned as we are with our children when they go. Because they weren't all, a lot of these kids were not troublesome. There were others that were giving them trouble also. And my heart went out to them because they needed the Lord. And I didn't hear of anybody getting saved through that, but that doesn't matter. I don't need to know that. I just know that the gospel was spoken to and an opportunity was had, and I jumped at it. That's the important thing. There are other times in my life where you get out of the box, they say. You gotta jump out of that box, and when God says something, you move.
Would you please stand with me?
All my wants and wishes.
share Him whose truth and faithfulness engage the waiting soul to bless. And since He bids me seek His face, believe His word and trust His grace, I'll cast on Him my hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer and wait. I'm sorry.
I thought we were just doing two verses.
Let's do verse 4. Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, may I thy consolation share. This robe of flesh I'll drop and rise to seize the everlasting prize, and shout while passing through the air, farewell, farewell, sweet hour of prayer. You may be seated.
Just a few more moments as we open the Word together, and thank you so much for being here today. But if you want to, maybe you have your phone or you want to look at Jeremiah chapter 1. I was thinking of different contexts to talk about, and my mom was one of those people that, if you know this, back in the day this happened a lot, but people would take the Bible and shade with colored pencils different sections of the Word, and that's how they did study and things along that line. My mom had no problem writing in her Bible. I struggle to write in a Bible. Maybe you're like that, but she had no problem writing things in the Bible. But as I was thinking about it, I came to the passage in Jeremiah chapter 1, and so let's pray as we look in the Word for just a few moments here. Father, thank you for it, and thank you for what has already been shared. It's just been beautiful, and I ask you, God, that you would use this time in your Word however you see fit, in Jesus' name, amen. I was thinking about the parallels that I see with the prophet Jeremiah and my mom. He was called the weeping prophet. And my mom, when she would cry, if you noticed, she was even trying to keep herself together as she's talking about those black moms, and you saw her rub that corner of her eye. She just had a love for all different people. And the burden that she would have for people in our neighborhood was amazing. And that's what, as you think about Jeremiah, his heart is broken over what has happened to Jerusalem. And when my mom would look at people, there wasn't this judgment at people. It was there's a reason why they're hurting. And Jeremiah understood why his people were hurting, and it's because they had turned their back on God. And her heart was towards people, and she cared about them, and she cared about us, and she cared about our schools, and she cared about our friends, and she cared about the parents of our friends. And so as Jeremiah starts here in this prophecy, it gets personal. In verse 4 of chapter 1, it says, "Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying..." Notice what it says here. It says, it doesn't say that Jeremiah came to the Lord. It's that the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah. And when I think about my mom's start in ministry, she had an understanding that God came her direction. And if you were to take the time, you can look it up on YouTube, hear her whole story. But she talks about how God was orchestrating stuff pre-Jesus in her life, in ways that, when I think back, that just the fact that we're here is amazing. This girl who is in a well-to-do family, they had help. That's how she called it. They had help, all right? And her mom, when she would talk to her mom about concerns like something is wrong, she'd go, "Joni, you're okay. You're okay." Because in her mom's mind, she was fine. She's good. She didn't kill anybody today. You know, it's that sort of thing. She's being as good as people are. But she knew something was wrong. And so she moves away from this, and she knows that there's people out there, and her mom would call people common. And my mom was, there's something wrong with that kind of thinking. And I think that's a work of God in her life. And so ultimately she comes to Chicago and meets a guy from La Crosse, Wisconsin, and they get married and have children. And what drove her to come? And I think that's a work of God, that ultimately he's orchestrating things to bring a person to himself, because the word of the Lord comes to us. I just love that. I love when you think about that, if you'd stop and think about how you got saved. How did God do that? It's amazing. He goes on and he says in verse 5, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you, and I appointed you a prophet to the nations." And so Jeremiah understands that God sets him apart in the womb. And if you look back in verse 1 of chapter 1, he's talking about the physical parents. But when it comes down to it, God is the one who is responsible for the formation. And she dedicated, once she became a Christian, she dedicated us to the Lord. And as my sister was talking to you, the reality is when we would be leaving for school, she would pray with us at the door. And as we would leave, she would say this, "Remember who your father is." And she wasn't talking about Bill Myers. Do you realize how bad that ruins a guy who wants to have mischief that day? Remember who you belong to. And it wasn't her. It was God. Because she knew that we were formed by God. She knew that we were known by God. She knew that we were consecrated by God, that we were appointed by God. And life is lived with God in mind. And he came up all the time. You know, sometimes you'd just like to come home and tell her that your friend's a jerk and that she would agree. But I was like, "Well, let's pray about that." "I don't want to pray about it. I want you to agree that they're a jerk," all right? But she was right. She was right. And to have that view of people. You see, when we were young, our mom forced us into situations that she knew we would be used for later for the glory of God. Drama, you're going to be in a drama, Mark. You said something about wanting to be in ministry. "Yeah, I know, but I didn't mean that I wanted to be forced to be Prince Charming in a play." "Well, that's my mom." "No, this will be good for you." Musicals. I was the mayor of the Munchkin City. Debate team. "You said you wanted to be a preacher. Well, you're going to learn how to get up in front." This is what she was like. It wasn't, "Oh, you don't want to do it. It's okay, honey." No, it wasn't okay, honey. We're going to force you to do these things. And God, I want to tell you, I'm grateful. She would do this stuff, this bold kind of, we're going to do this. Because she knew that God is calling us to things, all of us to things. And by the way, she loved all races. You look at Jeremiah here, a prophet to the nations. All races. White Meyers family. The Rivera's, Puerto Ricans, the Samita's, Japanese, the Scribner's, hillbillies. We're going to reach every one of those nations, all right? Remember, and I could go on about your mom. She goes down the street, and Barb Scribner is sitting on her porch smoking a cigarette. She did smoke, right? I'm not putting cigarettes in her mouth. Okay. She did smoke. Okay. And if you met Barb Scribner, you would go, I don't know if she's into this conversation at all. But my mom saw beyond that and witnessed to her and ultimately was able to lead her to Christ. And it's because she didn't just go, oh, I'll just keep going to the store. There's something more here. And by the way, for the Samitas, love them. The Riveras, love them. I could go down the block. Family after family praying for him. And then the kid across the street, Lance Korn, who was a bully to me. Still have attitude toward Lance, but anyways. She loved them. You'd heard the story she just shared about Tom Skinner. It's the heart of the Lord. Verse 6. Then I said, ah, Lord God, behold, I do not know how to speak, for I am a youth. Jeremiah is objecting to God. I don't want to do this. Mom was someone that took this calling seriously. And after she's saved by God's grace, she's trying to work to reach people. I remember one time she told me a story. She had just gotten saved. There was a pastor named Pastor Hamilton there. Here's her idea. Listen to my mom's idea of how to reach Chicago. She wanted to go down through the Chicago phone book, starting with A. Now, those of you that don't know, there's these things called phone books back in the day, before smartphones, and you could sit on the Chicago phone book and it would lift you up in the chair. She wanted to go and each person write them a letter witnessing to them about Jesus Christ. And you and I, and the pastor goes, Joan, that's a nice idea. Why don't we start with this neighborhood? All right. But did you see her heart? Verse 7. But the Lord said to me, do not say I am only a youth, for to all whom I send you, you shall go, and whatever I command you, you will speak. God's going to be with you every step of the way. And then this verse, and this is the verse that really clicked with me, and I want you to hear it. Verse 8 says this, do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, declares the Lord. You know in the King James what that verse is? Don't be afraid of their faces. Let me repeat that to you. Because I would say to my mom, sometimes I'm talking about the Lord and they look at me and stuff. She goes, don't be afraid of their faces. Jeremiah told them that. Because even now, some of you, I'm looking at you and you're like, oh, I'm tired. Or and I could read all these things and I don't know what's going on with you. My mom didn't allow that to stop her. Because every part of us thinks, oh, we don't have people figured out. We don't know what's going on. God knows. And here's our job. Share him. And so let me do this with you this morning. Let me give you the gospel for those of you here and those of you that are watching at home so that you can know that you know. We are all born sinners. Every one of us. We could never know if we've done enough good things to save ourselves. Because how do you know? Because the Bible says in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. I can't get there. The glory of God is out there. I always fall short of it. But he also says the wages of sin is death. So let me get this straight. Everybody's a sinner, and then if I'm a sinner, I get paid death. That's my salary. That's my wage. Yeah. But the verse doesn't end there. It says, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Do you know the difference between a wage and a gift? A wage is you and I earned it. A gift is something that I received. And so let me tell you, if you don't know this, Romans 10:9 says this, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. So let me ask you, do you know that you know? If you were to die today, would you know where you're going? My mom wanted to nail that one down regularly with people. And so I'm asking you this morning, do you know that you know? And if you don't, I would love to share with you more how you can know. Because that's the most important thing. That's why she stopped in the checking line. Because eternity is eternity. And that's my prayer for you and our family's prayer for you, and it was my mom's prayer for you. So please don't pass up on that opportunity. I was thinking about another thing as we're wrapping up here this morning. It's so good to know. Isn't it good to know we have heaven? It isn't some, oh, that's good. That's nice you believe that. It's the truth. We've got heaven. I heard Kim and I were going through the Smoky Mountains and wanted to play some music as we're going through the Smoky Mountains. And we turn on Amazon Music, and there was this group, Daly and Vincent, and they were singing this song called On the Other Side. And we thought it would be a nice way to wrap up with the service, because heaven is such a beautiful thing. And this is just a nice picture of heaven. Take a listen to On the Other Side.
Are paved with gold, and you never grow old on the other side. On the other side, everybody sings. With gold, and you never grow old on the other side. On the other side, everybody sings. There's miles and miles of flowers and lots of pretty things where the sky a perfect blue, and everything looks brand new on the other side. Well, I've never been to heaven. I didn't know what it was like, but God let me have a glimpse in my dream last night. And I knew everything was gonna be all right on the other side. On the other side. On the other side. Do you ever see me cry? Do you know how much I miss you? Wish I could have said goodbye. Just one more I love you. Oh, am I really getting through on the other side? Well, I've never been to heaven. I didn't know what it was like, but God let me have a glimpse in my dream last night.
Inviting those that are family and out-of-town guests to make their way downstairs for a lunch that this church has graciously provided for us. Would you stand as we close our time together? Let's pray. Father, thank you for your goodness and grace. You are the God of all power and control, and we're grateful to you for all that you've done. Thank you so much for our mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, friend, what you've done. And in the words of Jude, now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. And all God's people said, amen. Thanks, you're dismissed.